We're on.
Hi. Everyone.
I'm James Wesley.
I'm Seth Rudetsky.
Welcome to Stars in the House.
Hey, look, it's snowing out here in New York. I don't know if you can really see that. Welcome to Stars in the House. What is Stars in the House? It is a daily, two times a day show where we're raising money for the Actors Fund. Our goal is to make people feel more connected during the social distancing, and we're raising money for the Actors Fund. And there is a lot of this information about the Actors Fund. It's not just for actors.
Right.
It's also for actresses. Now, it's for anybody in the business, musicians, sure. Ballet people, ballet dancers, opera people, people that work backstage, people that work front of house, box office personnel.
Coast to coast. And we're talking about opera companies, symphonies, ballets. This helps everyone.
Wedding singers.
That's right.
Anyone that makes their living.
Speaking of Laura Benanti.
Yeah, Laura Benanti is a wedding singer. We'll discuss that way later.
People may be wondering why we had watched our first 13 shows, why we're on opposite sides, Seth.
Oh, yeah, just in case. Basically, because your shoulder's bothering
you. I'm not playing the piano. You would not want to hear that. No, I had shoulder surgery a couple years ago, and I'm choosing, because I don't really need to, go in for a PT and all that, but I'm just trying to. It's kind of hurting my left shoulder.
By the way, when I was on the Rosie O'Donnell show, I don't know if you remember, the whole month of December on the Rosie O'Donnell show, Rosie's desk suddenly switched. And everyone was like, why is your desk? Rosie's like, I don't know, I just kind of want my desk over here. It's because the end of the month, the guest star was Barbara Streisand. And Barbara wanted to be filmed from a certain angle.
Oh, I remember that.
Remember Rosie was like, oh, just for funsies, I'm going to move my desk. Like, uh-huh. Anyway, but that's not why we moved. All right.
So today's celebration is about a certain composer.
I'm obsessed with Andrew Lloyd Webber. It was his birthday yesterday. We couldn't do two birthday celebrations. So today is Andrew Lloyd Webber's birthday celebration, which we're going to do the second half of the show with his stars, Sierra Boggess and Ramin Karimloo. So stay tuned for that. But we've got so many. I keep burping because I just drank something. Go. So many updates. Go. Sorry.
Okay. Well, and we have another guest, but we can save her. We're going to see her in a minute.
Yeah.
First off, please, everyone, share the link.
Share right now what you're watching. Just go to your social media. Just share it on your Facebook, your Twitter. The more people that are watching, the more people that will A, be cheered up, B, will be donating. So share right now. Just copy it and share. And speaking of donating, can we discuss some donations?
Yeah, we can. These are a few that came in at the end of the last show. Let me put on my glasses.
Yeah, we get a little list.
Of course, go to actressfund.org.
Wait, look, my sister, I knew it. Totally thought James was playing Barbara Streisand.
That is funny.
No, okay. His shoulder.
All right. So there's a few thank yous here to Dolores in New York, $25. That's so funny, Nancy. Mark from New York, $169. Timothy from Colorado, $25. Another Colorado.
Yeah.
Hannah, $111. And Jane from California, $51. Thank you so much.
Are we allowed to give our final total for the week?
You know what? I don't know if I have.
I do. Right.
You do? Oh, good.
Literally from last week, we began Monday night, and we really have been really just publicizing
slowly
kind
growing
of
it,
ourselves.
Yeah.
The fact that we began Monday night and we really want to just make people feel better, and if they can donate, and people are donating $5, $10, not that much, we have raised, it's incredible, over the last week, $80,000.
Right. That's all for the Actors Fund.
All for the Actors Fund.
Yeah.
It is incredible. Like we said, it's for anybody in the entertainment field. Okay, what else?
So the other thing is, I just wanted to share, I'm going to keep saying this, the importance of supporting small businesses in your community and perhaps reaching out in ways that you haven't before. And I'm gonna give you an example. So Julie does artwork. She's a great artist and she has a few commissions. And so we had a family discussion last night about what the safest way was to get it to the person. And so we were like, do we go to the post office? And you know, there's certain ways we could go and what's the best way? And we were like, well, there's a UPS store that's independently owned and operated that we've used before. It'd be nice to support them. And instead of ordering the special envelope through Amazon, how about getting it from them the way we have in the past? And so I literally called her and found out her name for the first time. And I said, hey, what's your name? And she said, Ellen. And I tried to remind her of who I was and who Seth was, and we'd been in there before. And she said, sure, whatever you feel most comfortable with. We're all kind of figuring out the new normal. And she said, if you don't feel comfortable coming into the store, you can leave it outside the door of the business. We're only allowing two people in there at a time anyway. This is in New Jersey, sorry. And so that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna take Julie's artwork to mail it to the person who commissioned her. And I'm gonna leave it outside. I'm gonna be in the car and I'm gonna tell Ellen, this is my credit card number. How much is it? And that's how we're going to do it.
Hold on, I have to send her out to the poop the link.
Well, while you're doing that. So yesterday, surprising us in a great way was Joanna Gleason here yesterday celebrating Stephen Sondheim's birthday. And she surprised us by literally getting out the staff that Bernadette Peters used in Into the Woods. And she is, after 30 years of having it in her house, she is going to auction it off to benefit the Actors Fund. And I think the last bid was $1,026.
Yes.
Now, people have been writing in to starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com or going on to our starsinthehouse.com website and emailing. And we're in the process right now of developing, or I'm not one of our many volunteers, Vanessa, is looking at a site that you can do it where it's like eBay, you know, or Charity Buzz, where you can see what the last bid was. But in the meantime, if you can top $1,026, Joanna Gleason wants it to be available for auction from now until Sunday. And that's what we're going to do.
Yeah, every day we're going to be auctioning stuff off. Once we figure out, did you show the this is the actual Bernadette Peters.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, it's great. You want to bring on our first? Oh, we have to bring in Dr. LaPook.
Is Dr. Yes.
LaPook available right now?
Hi, Dr. LaPook. Here he is.
Hi,
guys. Hi, Dr. LaPook.
I see you. I felt like the person who you sent an invitation to the birthday party, but it was to the wrong address. You gave me last night's link.
Siri Cruz.
We tried.
So wait, speaking of last night, we want up to the minute medical updates. Dr. LaPook, what's happening?
You know, it's more kind of the same. We have this fight between flattening the curve. So everybody's doing what they're supposed to do. Hopefully now everybody's on the same page. We're staying away from each other. We're washing our hands for 20 seconds. We're sneezing into the crook of our arm or into a tissue, all to flatten the curve so that we don't have all of these cases at once that are overwhelming the healthcare system. I'm hearing from my buddies on the front lines who are in hospitals throughout the country, actually. You're starting to see cracks. Okay, there are certain hospitals where they've run out of N95 masks. And I want to make a special appeal out there to people. Please don't hoard. Specifically, these medications you've heard about that might, underlined from Tony Fauci, might work, like hydroxychloroquine. Those are medicines that are used by people right now for rheumatoid arthritis and for lupus and other conditions. So if they don't have it and they run out, they're going to end up in the hospital. If they end up in the hospital, they're going to overwhelm the system even more. They're vulnerable. They may actually get sick. They may get the doctors and nurses and other health professionals sick. And guess what? From a selfish point of view, if you're hoarding the medicines on your shelf and your bathroom not being used, that can come back to bite you, because if you get sick, the healthcare system won't be there for you in full force. So it's, again, I know we're saying this over and over again, people have to be thinking about society. And then I also want to give a shout out to you guys, because I've been hearing from everybody at these moments of physical distancing, emotional connectivity. It's the name of the game. We have to do it. And you know that I will cry at a McDonald's commercial, so I won't go on too long about how amazing the arts are and how they always have been. We need the science. We need the scientists. But I remember after the Pulse, that horrific shooting at the Pulse nightclub, you guys got everybody together for what the world needs now is love, sweet love. And what the world needs now is love, sweet love. And also for everybody to be together at one, with one cause. We're fighting one enemy here.
We're going to bring you back. We're going to bring you back. Thank you, Dr. John LaPook.
You're seeing a little bit.
Amazing that you're always here with us.
Love it.
Okay, so we'd like to bring up our first guest star, Tony Award winner, basically TV star, just a social activist, brilliant comedian, which we'll be discussing. Please welcome the incredible Laura Benanti.
Here, I'll take my glasses off. Hi.
You look so cute, Laura Benanti.
Do I?
No.
Do I look like I might smell?
No, not at all. Okay, so let's just start from the beginning. Like I always say, please God, why are you not pronouncing it the real Italian way, Benanti?
Because I'm from New Jersey, and we say Benanti.
Benanti.
It's so no Italian accent. Let me ask you something. The reason I led into that is because you're actually broadcasting from New Jersey.
Yeah. Where else do you want to be during a pandemic? New Jersey.
Do you? Okay. So, Laura Benanti, I have 1,000 questions. We mentioned Wedding Singer before. Can we just discuss your look for that?
That's a generous word for it. I mean, we've talked about this so many times. They were like, how do we make me look like the girl next door? Which And they were like, let's just have her wear this wig, which was just like four strands of like Gollum hair.
Basically, the way you described it is you said someone was in a dressing room, one of the cleaning crew, they were wiping down a counter and they said, this is her wig.
Hold on.
Put it on your head.
Perfect.
You still got it. Okay, Laura Benanti, where do you keep your Tony Award?
On the piano in my house where I don't live anymore because I live over here.
Oh, your actual house because you're with your mom. Okay, so we wanted to know, James, ask your signature question.
Oh, what are you and your family doing to stay healthy, Laura?
To stay healthy? We're
physical, spiritual, emotional, any of that.
Yeah, so we're, you know, we're really taking very seriously the social distancing. So we have not left our home for a long, 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 long time. Right. My husband went to the grocery store for us. He wore gloves. Then I made him strip down in the garage. Wow. And I put all of his clothes in a bag. And then he immediately took a shower. Like, we're really taking it very seriously. We're trying to eat as healthy as possible. Also, like, rationing our food, trying not to be, like, too binge crazy. Yeah. Because it's easy to just be like, everything's terrible. But if we get into a situation where we need our food, I want to have it for us and also for others. So we've been exercising. We've been really working on our prison bodies. Yeah, I'm going to have 18 packs by the time this is done.
Oh, you already do. So I wanted to say something about Laura. So Laura started this amazing thing. Laura, like me, we all grew up doing high school theater. A lot of high school theater has been postponed or canceled. Like me, Laura knows how devastating it is when you've been rehearsing, by the way, all year for two performances of a musical. So talk about what you started, which I'm obsessed with.
So my mom is a voice teacher, and we were talking, and she was saying how devastated she is for all of her voice students who aren't able to do their school musicals. So I thought, you know what, let me just like quick run out to the porch. I'm going to send this message through Instagram to let them know if they want to tag me, I'm going to watch their videos. And I thought I would get like 20.
Yeah.
You know, and at this point, there are, I mean, the video has been viewed 3.7 million times.
That's incredible.
And I've received on Instagram alone over 2,000 videos. And I would imagine the same on Twitter. And I have watched them all.
You're amazing.
Good for you. I
comment on them. And I really want these kids to know, I really want them to understand how grateful I am. I've gotten so many messages from people saying, this is my only bright spot right now, my only bright spot. Aww. And it's given them an outlet to be seen by Lin-Manuel Miranda and all of these incredible celebrities who are also commenting, Stephanie J. Block and Shoshana Bean. They're like watching, commenting, telling these kids what a great job they're doing. And then my friend, Kate Dieter Meriday, and I, she's a mediator down south, and she and I are gonna create basically like an email address where kids who want to participate can send in their sunshine songs, and we are going to get them to senior housing, hospitals, and anybody who is isolated, because so many people are isolated right now and they don't have Twitter and they don't have Instagram and they don't understand it, but they do understand an email link that they receive that they just click on and then they get to watch it.
So Laura, when you... Yeah. When you have that, you'll come back and you'll share that with everyone, right?
100%.
Okay, so my next thing, because I know Seth has something, is that I saw you perform for the first time, actually, when you were in The Sound of Music. I had just moved to New York. I had seen the amazing Rebecca Luker in that production. And then I had read about this 18-year-old who was had the nerve to be in this show, who actually is the right age, but I had never... You were 18, right?
I was 18.
Yeah, and of course you were amazing.
Thank you.
I think I've seen you in just about everything you've done since then on Broadway. But you told us, not a but you also, you told us that you have something special from that production to kind of follow in line from Joanna Gleason. Go. Yeah.
So I have a few pairs of shoes that I wore on stage in The Sound of Music that I've been saving. And I can take pictures of them all. And then if people want to buy them or, you know, donate, auction them, whatever the word is,
they can
choose the one that they want. So I think, how many do I have? Like four? I think I have four. So I'll auction off two.
Oh my gosh.
And then I'll sign them or not sign them, whatever.
That's amazing. So for now, until we have the website up and running a la eBay, go to Stars in the House 2020. Hey, Laura, do you think you could like send us a picture of them and like hold them up and then we can post it?
Yep, I absolutely will.
Go, Seth.
So speaking of Sunshine Songs, someone had that question for you.
What Sunshine Song video really spoke to you? You know what? The thing that I love about this initiative is the internet is a place that can be so mean, and there has not been one single negative comment on any of those kids' videos. I don't want to choose one because I don't want it to become a contest.
Yeah.
I feel like we've built a collaborative community and we're in like the world's biggest musical together. And so I don't want to single anybody out because all of them are special to me and all of them are beautiful. And I will tell you, every single one of them shows commitment, sincerity, love, passion, you know, so I couldn't choose one. I really couldn't.
But if you had to, it was probably my performance as the rabbi in ninth grade. And,
thank you for saying it.
It was actually, my voice hadn't changed yet. So it was like, a blessing on your head. Mazel tov. It was so low for me. Mazel tov, mazel. Okay, now speaking of awkwardness, we got to spend 2 minutes and I was just listening and laughing so hard just a couple days ago to your cow and Gypsy. Can you please, it is so brilliant. Can you please discuss how that happened? Because it was one of those like out of necessity became brilliant because it wasn't really planned at first, right?
No, I mean, I always felt like, you know, she's so, Louise is not meant to be a performer.
No, but what I meant was that you didn't know you were going to be the cow. Remember, you didn't know it was going to be you. So you were sitting around just sort of marking it. So talk about, that's what I meant. Go.
Yeah. I like, I don't know why. I was like, someone else will be the cow. And then it was me. So I was just like, moo, 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 moo. And Arthur Lawrence was like, yes.
Wait, so wait, I literally have the music, so I'd love for you to recreate it. Bring your mouth a little closer to the mic so we can hear you. I'll be June. I have a moo cow, a new cow, a true cow named Caroline.
Moo, moo, moo.
She's an extra special friend of mine.
Moo, 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 moo.
I like everything about her fine.
Moo, 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 moo.
It's so awkward.
Laura, if you knew how many times we do moo 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 in our house.
Oh my God, it's so funny. Okay, you're brilliant. Okay, so speaking of houses, you're actually with your mom, who, by the way, was your voice teacher.
Yes, and is it still continues to be.
She still lives.
Get in. She still lives.
She still lives.
This is her. You got to be able to see.
I know you got to.
Oh boy. Uh-huh. There she is.
Hi. I can also do this. That's a little bit better.
Oh, relax.
Okay, so do you go by Mrs. Benanti or Mrs. Benanti?
Having come from Virginia, I would not know how to pronounce it at all. But my husband is very firm about Benanti because he's from Garfield, New Jersey, and that's the way they say it.
But also, never say my husband is very firm. Ever again.
Thank you. You're a social activist. By the way, why do you both look the same age?
I know, right?
Okay, you.
How dare you?
That's not what I meant. But hilarious.
70 years old.
I'll talk to you privately. Okay.
No, you won't.
Okay, tell us what we're gonna get. What we're gonna get. I'm gonna take off. Yeah. Here, you tell.
Okay.
Wait, hold on. Wait. What'd you say? What'd you say? One more time.
Oh, we were just singing upstairs to my daughter Ella, and this is what we were singing. And then I thought, oh, we should sing this for everybody else. Ready?
Mm-hmm. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. The other night, dear, as I lay sleeping, I dreamed I held you in my arms. When I awoke, dear, I was mistaken.
and I hung my head, and I cried.
Shouldn't we end it happier? That's where it ends. It was so beautiful.
Oh, it has, it goes back to verse one, and then it gets happy.
Well, they're not happy times, Linda. Wake up.
You guys sound amazing together. I couldn't even tell who was on.
Couldn't tell the difference.
Kind of like how we look.
You look exactly the same. By the way, sorry.
Oh.
But you got this.
Everybody can talk it.
You got this. You got that.
Look at that one, Laura.
What an unbelievably lucky.
I help babysit. So
she does.
So, Benanti, before you go, we did. You've done so many benefits for me. We did that crazy one. We should talk about. Bring it back.
That's privately.
I can't. But you did that beautiful one for Katie O'Hara, and you sang that a cappella song. I think people would really love to hear that right now, and talk about why you're going to sing it.
So, my mom, do you want to get out of here for this? Is it going to make you cry? All right, she's going to get out because she's going to cry. So, my mom was a voice teacher, or my mom was a Broadway singer. And then my parents got divorced when I was like, how old was I?
16 months.
I was like 16 months old. My parents got divorced. I'm fine. And my mom stopped acting so that she could be a mom in a more meaningful way to her. And when I was like 5 years old, I was walking up the stairs and I saw my mom standing on her tiptoes with her arms outstretched, and she was singing as if to an imaginary audience. And it was, I say this a lot in my first moment of differentiation from my mom, where because kids are like, we're one, but it was the first moment where I realized that I am me and she is her, and that she has things that she loves and things that she longs for and talents. And even at five, I knew that she had like a God-given gift that she sacrificed for me and my sister. And so this is the song she was singing. Do you want to sing it with me?
No.
She says no.
A little bit.
Are you sure?
No, you go ahead.
Come on.
Yeah, you come on.
We want Mrs. Benanti.
Oh, jeez.
Yay.
Okay. I'll just point to you when it's your turn. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. When it all comes true, just the way you planned. It's funny, but the bells don't ring. It's a quiet thing when you hold the world in your trembling hands. You'd think you'd hear a choir sing. It's a quiet thing. There are no exploding fireworks. Where's the roaring of the crowd? Maybe it's a strange new atmosphere way up here. Among the clouds, but I don't hear the drums, I don't hear the band, the sounds I'm told such moments bring. Happiness comes in on tiptoe. Where would you know? It's a quiet thing, a very quiet thing.
Oh my gosh. Okay, wait. The voices are exactly the same. The placement, the scooping, the breathing. That was so incredible. Wait, oh.
Look at that.
I've always loved this song, but love it even more hearing this duet.
Thanks, Greg.
And I agree with this. You two sound exactly the same. I mean, oh, this is lovely. Yeah, oh, how nice for some people. I love it to sing with your mom. I miss my mom.
Oh.
You guys, that is so incredible. One more we have to show.
This is the sweetest, and it's making me miss my mom so much. She's in Seattle working at a hospital, and I'm in Los Angeles.
Thank you to your mom. Thank you.
Absolutely.
You guys, you okay? You both have to.
You both have to be.
Yeah,
back.
Linda, you gotta come back. Laura, peace out. The placement, the breathing. I'm so obsessed. Okay, so you're gonna come back. Thank you.
And remind stars in the house 2020 at Gmail.
Oh yeah.
Until we get the site up for the auction.
Yeah, if you want to bid, on the shoes.
And we can have dueling bid. Yeah, two winners.
Stars in the House 2020.
Well, that's
Gmail.
Not the staff, but yeah. I mean, Stars in the House.
And they decide signed or not signed, whatever they want.
We'll let you know.
Just go to starsinthehouse.com for details. All right, we're going to see you guys soon. Thank you so much for coming.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Okay, we got to celebrate a little Andrew Lloyd Webber's birthday. I'm so excited. We've got two Andrew Lloyd Webber stars to celebrate the birthday with.
Wait.
The fabulous, right from New York, Miss Sierra Boggess. There she is. Hi, Sierra Boggess.
Hi. And Olivia.
An angel.
Whenever I come in my music room, she needs to sit here.
My cat would do that. I always sit in my lap. Now my other one goes upstairs.
But my other one's like, I'm out.
We have direct from London, your phantom himself, looking amazing, Mr. Ramin Karimloo. Hi, Ramin.
Hello.
Hey, Ramin.
What's in back of you, Ramin? You guys, catch up later. What's in the back of you, I mean?
Yeah, it's a little scary. It's a little scary.
Oh, yeah, he got that Never Dies. Didn't you?
Yeah, it's the light is not helping right now. Let me turn off the light and see what happens.
His arm is, like, so freaky.
yeah.
I can forget anything. Ramin, what's it like in London? What's going on there?
Probably what you guys are going through in New York. I think you might be a week or two behind us, but we're half and half with some people being ass clowns, not taking it seriously and thinking it's a day off work and a holiday where our hospitals are too full. It's crazy, man. It's crazy.
Are your kids home from school?
Yeah. I tried to do homeschooling and I realized after 30 minutes that teachers deserve $1 million a year.
Okay, so Sarah, what's it like for you? Were you in the middle of a job when this all went down?
Absolutely not. No, you know, all my shows cancel before they go into rehearsal, so I was fine.
Wait, actually, we tell that story because that is actually nice to remember. Talk about that show that happened with.
Yeah.
What, Le Fantôme?
No, I was. Oh, yeah, that one too.
Which one, Seth?
I'm talking about Rebecca, but you know what?
Well, okay. The Andrew Webber celebration.
So yeah, talk about Le Fantôme.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the last time I was supposed to do Phantom of the Opera was I left School of Rock. It was the last time I was on Broadway. And so they took me to Paris. I learned the entire thing in French. And then the theater caught on fire during rehearsals. And that was it. So that was like, and we were out. That was just exit. Au flambé.
But you guys did something, though, that's sort of in the spirit of the times we're living in now. Out of that tragedy, something beautiful happened, right?
Yeah. So, of course, I mean, I was devastated because I love that show more than anything. And I had moved to Paris and was all excited. But I was the only American there. So everybody who lives in Paris and that's like the show they were going to do. Right. You know, they don't have other options, like a whole mess of other options. And so we were all like at a pub and then eventually, and people were just getting more and more sad. And I was like, come on, you guys. And we sprint to the steps of the Paris Opera House. I'm not, because we were only but like 10 feet. And we like sprinted and we just did this impromptu like sing song of Masquerade and Hannibal and like all this stuff. And it was like the most amazing. And our MD was with us and he happened to have a accordion. So it was like, of course, because you're in Paris, it was like the most French thing that could ever happen. So yeah, it is like what we're doing now. Because all of us are like, so can we sing? Like, that's, and what are people asking for just but music?
Well, you know what? We want to say Dr. John LaPook keeps saying, our doctor, that we've got to keep in touch with people socially, that to not isolate. So we wanted to bring on one of your pals. Rex Smith is here. I know you guys love Rex. Hi, Rex.
Hey, what's up?
Oh my God, Rex, it's amazing. I haven't seen you in so long. You look so different.
Yeah, yeah, that's what people tell me. It's been a while, yeah.
Yeah, it has been a while.
What's up, Ramin?
Rex, you still owe me 20 bucks.
20? Oh, sorry, dude. I thought I paid you that night. I'm so sorry.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Anyway, how's your mother?
Why is the name up? Why is Norm Lewis's name up there?
That's weird. Oh.
Wait a minute.
So
what are you wearing on your head?
This is my Javert wig from London.
Yes. Thank you so much. And why haven't you let me borrow that?
Look at the stuff. Isn't it neat and shit? I'm sorry.
This is a mistake. This already is a mistake.
Listen, I just want to say this. You guys are amazing. I love you. I miss you all. I the social distancing and all that stuff. but yeah, this is fantastic. James and Seth, thank you so much for doing all this. You are just such a lover of this art and lover of us. And thank you for just being the heart of Broadway. You are the mayor of Broadway, man. You really are.
Hi.
Wait, hold on. So can I do one tribute to Andrew Lloyd Webber?
We love him.
To me. You ready? There I was standing in front of the vine. I took some grape and I crushed them to wine. Gave them to Pharaoh who drank from my cup. I tried to interpret, but I had to give up.
That was the first show I ever did with Norm, and those are the riffs I gave him.
Non-equity, right?
Non-equity.
Non-equity.
I forgot that was Andrew Lloyd. There I was standing in front of a pine. That's the slide we did at the end.
I don't know where I went with that one. I don't know. But listen, I love you guys. That's it. I love you. Bye.
We love you.
All right. So
why was Rex here for 20 seconds? Where's Rex? Where'd he go? Why is the name still up?
Ramin, you're so hilarious. You've got to do a damn comedy. You're so hilarious. Okay, so Ramin, I want to get a damn song. I didn't get the sound check. I know it's not an Andrew Lloyd Webber song. I just said, please sing anything. What do you got to do me?
Well, look, what's appropriate? What do you mean, just sing? We can't just randomly sing.
Banjo or something.
Any requests on the side? I'm going to go to comments right now. Anybody have any requests for Ramin to sing?
Ramin's never sung, though. It's going to be so exciting. For his first time ever.
Ramin, you're my role model. You've got me through many hard times, so thank you. Oh, that's very sweet. Well, someone said, please sing Phantom.
Do you know it?
I could just be a little bit even.
Not on guitar. I want to have it on guitar.
I don't know Phantom on guitar.
Okay, you've got a lot of... Oh, how about this? You know this on guitar? No, the other one. Hold on. I just saw it. Wait.
Hold on.
How do you get text up there? What are you using to do this? How do you do this?
It's
where you use StreamYard.com, and that's what we're encouraging everyone to use so they can connect to, you know, their theater, local theater community too.
Yeah, that way people can do their own benefits.
Yeah.
But how about Bring Him Home? Can you play that on guitar?
No. If I go on YouTube and find a backing track of something?
You can try.
Well, do we want to have Sierra sing right now?
Yeah, Sierra, why don't you sing while Ramin rudely ignores you and goes on YouTube to find a backing track? You have so many Phantom requests, so give us some kind of
unreal.
Oh, no. The words are here. Hang on.
Oh. He's got it so quick. Wow.
For that one?
I don't know.
It's karaoke. Nighttime sharpens, heightens each sensation. Sing on. Darkness.
I've never heard it.
Thirst. Can you hear it right? And wakes.
Now
silently the senses abandon their defenses. Where's my cassette? Here she go. Get us both back. Seth. Thank you. I'm not going to do the whole thing. Oh, it's such a long song. Slowly, gently, night unfurls its splendor. It, sense it, tremulous and tender. Here we go. Turn your face away.
from the garish light of day. Turn your thoughts away from cold and feeling light, and listen to the music of the night.
I'm gonna forward it, it's so long. Hang on. Here we go.
The darkness of the music of the night. Let your mind start a journey through a strange new world. Leave all thoughts of the world you knew before. Let your soul take you where you long to be. Can you belong to me? Lord, sweet intoxication, touch me, trust me, save the beast and sensation. Let the dream begin, let your darker side give in to the power of the music that I write. The power of the music of the night.
Are you passing out here? Are you doing the New York?
Yeah, I'm gonna pass.
God. Oh. Put you down. It's big instrumental.
You alone can make my song take flight. Help me make the music.
And I agree. You guys cheered me up. That was amazing. Oh,
yeah. That's the point.
Woo! That was like theater magic, man.
Yeah.
Ooh. Oh. Okay, so you clowns, you're both going to come back. I want to bring on our chief medical correspondent, because every show should have a chief medical correspondent, no matter what.
Dr. That was amazing. That was so good. Can I make a comment here?
Yes, sir.
Medical commentary. That was so amazing, that very first show when I choked up talking about the arts and what they do, and we rely on the science and the scientists, but really if we're going to be saved, it's by the arts and the artists, and it's always been that way. And Laura Benanti said, she talked about how there wasn't any meanness in any of the kind. Normally on social media, when there are mean people out there, mean comments, but when all the kids were posting their performances, there was not one mean comment. And if you're going to be I don't want to be a Pollyanna. My mother was always looking for the silver lining in things. And today actually is the 11th anniversary of when she died. Music.
Take your time.
This is an opportunity for us to Control-Alt-Delete, reboot, and come up to a kinder, gentler society where she, Laura, said not only for us, but for others. And if there's a silver lining to that, this moment, this painful moment, it's that. And if we're going to be led, it's going to be by you guys. Mm-hmm. So.
That's beautiful. And it's funny, I was saying to Sierra in text messaging last night, I was like, what would be super sad is after all this, we don't come out with any lessons. Amen. I don't want to go back to how we were. I think we can be better.
We're running 100 miles an hour towards what? Slow down. You guys are musicians. What do you call this? I don't know what you call this.
Andante.
We need to go slow. And my mother's great thing of she would go to, you've heard this, you'd go to peel an orange. She really would do this over and over again. And she'd hold the unpeeled orange in her hand. She would say, at this moment, this orange has never seen the light of day. And then she'd peel it.
Sierra, I knew you would love that.
I love that.
This moment, this orange. So my mom and dad, my dad died 2 years ago, a few months shy of 100. Wow. And was in the Battle of the Bulge. So he would have told you, we're going to get through this. He got through Pearl Harbor. And he would have said, we got this. And he was very realistic. But I'll say it again. This will have a beginning. We're probably at the end of the beginning, a middle and an end. But we're going to come through it. A bumpy ride. We're going to do it together. But we have to all think together as one, not selfishly. We have to think of what we can do for each other and how we can reach out. And that's what you guys do. That's the filter that I've seen in the arts. Is that I don't know what it is about that filter, but you guys have that. So teach us. Keep giving it to us.
Here, Dr. LePoe.
Well, listen, it's a two-way street.
So let me ask, Ramin, I know that you're kind of at the beginning of this. You're a little bit behind the United States. Do you have any questions you'd like to ask to Dr. LePook at all? Are you wondering about anything?
Listen, I probably have the same questions that everyone else has been asking. And I don't have any questions. I just wish that we could all, like, sing from the same hymn sheet on this one and beat it together. Because I feel like with what's happening here in England and what I see in America and now in Canada, we have the blueprints already of how China has seemingly got it on control. South Korea's done amazing things. Japan, I don't even think they've skipped a beat. And I think, why aren't we doing what they did? I know they were testing and there were more testing for antibodies to get people back to work. So
you have to believe it. That's what I've been saying this. So you have to believe that bending, flattening the curve makes a difference. And you're exactly right. In China, in South Korea, it works. But we have to believe it. And that means the knuckleheads who are still congregating and on the beach. I saw the pictures of Bondi Beach and in Sydney, people all together. And my wife told me she saw it on the beach in California. This is not the time to do that. And we can't go off the air today without talking about the increasing reports of racism, of people spitting on people of Asian descent, or even thinking that you're of Asian descent, and not that anybody deserves it. We really have to stop that. We have to shame that behavior, and we have to be there. We have to have their backs every time. I've been reading about the history of these outbreaks over centuries since the time of before Hippocrates. Every time there's an outbreak, there's a scapegoat. Every time. It's going to be this group. It's going to be that group. I remember Ebola very well, people from West Africa. And now we're seeing that with people of Asian descent. And we have to be unmistakably unified against that kind of behavior. We have to shout it out, call it out, and we have to be there for them because they're our brothers and sisters.
Dr. LePoke, we have a special surprise guest who actually wants to ask you a question.
Well, first of all, somebody that I literally worship.
Yes.
I mean, literally worship. But he also has a question for you.
But you probably mean figuratively worship, but I'm going to let it pass.
No, I'm going to say literally. I have a shrine.
When you see who it is, you will know, Dr. LePoke, why Seth is saying this.
But he also has a question for you. Please answer the question of Sir, Lord, everything else, Andrew, Lloyd.
Well, oh, my gosh. Wow.
Hello, everybody. Hi. No, I've got an opportunity to ask a doctor a question that I think quite a lot of people are asking. I mean, we all know that there are a very limited number of test kits, unfortunately, at the moment. And we also know that there is the possibility of a kit now coming along, which means that you could be tested to see not whether you've had it or not whether you've got it, but whether you've had it. One view that I heard expressed over the weekend, which interested me, is why are we not taking groups of people at random and testing them so that we get some information? Because the truth is, none of us really have any information about the extent of this. I mean, I was very intrigued by one thing about the cruise boat, which was full of old people like me. You know, and of the 700 on the boat, seven died, which is 1%. And if that's old people, you begin to think, we don't have really that much information. Would you agree that it would be a good idea to test, as it were, pockets of people to see where this virus is going?
Well, you may be Sir Andrew Lloyd Webber, but that could also be Dr. Andrew Lloyd Webber, because that is exactly the question that our scientists have been asking. I actually have been talking about it quite frequently, which, and what you're referring to for people who don't know, is you have the PCR test, which you put, you know, you put the swab up your nose, the back of your throat, and just looking for active infection with virus. What you're talking about is an antibody test. It's a blood test, and you're looking for antibodies to show that you had the infection. That's these two different types of antibodies. IgM shows that it's a recent infection. IgG shows it's a more past infection. You've all had that, you know, if anybody, you know, is looking for measles, mumps, rubella, German measles to see before pregnancy, and you say, oh yeah, I'm immune, or for measles, oh, look at that, I need a booster. We 100,000 zillion % need that, because that's how we're gonna know what the community spread is. And after all, you've got something that can go from no symptoms to you have severe pneumonia on the brink of death. So that's a pretty widespread. So if we want to get our arms around this, we have to do that kind of testing. It's being developed right now. I'm actually in communication with some people who are trying to ramp up on that. One of the things that's so amazing and gives me hope is that you have a bunch of these labs, like the Broad Institute, you know, which is a big genetics institute, and MIT, places around the country. They're twisting their labs that are up for genetics and other things, and they're turning them into labs that are going to research COVID. So I think we're going to get that testing very quickly. It's going to be super important. And it's not only going to tell us how wide it is, because if there are lots of asymptomatic cases, the mortality rate will be lower than we think, right? So if right now there's 10 people out of whatever the number, if there's one person out of 100, let's just make that up, one death out of 100, if it turns out that there are 900 people we don't know about who have been infected, then it's one death out of 1,000. And that's about the death rate for flu, which is still a huge death rate. So that's super important. And also give us some idea of who might be immune. So if those people have already had it, should start contributing to what's called herd immunity, H-E-R-D. And what that is about, like, think of a herd of sheep. And if there's a weak one in the middle, they're protected by having all the strong ones around it. So herd immunity, for when it comes to viral illnesses, you get to a certain amount, 80, 90%, a little more, you start getting enough people who are immune that you protect those vulnerable people. And also, once we know the people who are immune, think about it. We could put them in the right places. If they're healthcare workers, put them more on the front lines, because they should be protected. We have to figure that out, exactly how long they're protected, if they're protected. But you asked the perfect question. It's exactly what there's a lot of science about right now. So it's a very sophisticated, good question.
It seems,
and you can write songs. So there's
sophisticated question in the song. Vital thing to do, because we don't know, do we, what economic damage is being done either. I mean, we don't know how long it's going to take for everybody to recover. And you think of the draconian shutdown, not just of Broadway or the West End. I mean, really, it's across the board. And our Prime Minister is about to talk tonight, I gather, in an hour or so. And I suspect he's going to be shutting down London. And I mean, we simply don't know. And my concern is that, you know, we are maybe in Britain turning away people who need operations that they're going to cost them their lives, with something that we really don't understand enough about.
And the particular period now that's so tricky is that there's a backlog. You know, Ambassador Burks, BIRX, told us, she's in the coronavirus task force for the president. There's a backlog of these tests that have been sitting there waiting to be tested. So suddenly they're processed, they're positive. It's hard to trust the numbers right now, because yes, they're going up. And you mentioned about people who are out there who need operations. Boy, is that ever a huge thing. Because when you have a healthcare system that's overloaded, and let's look at people who are who need this hydroxychloroquine, which is Plaquenil, and they've got lupus, they've got rheumatoid arthritis, and now suddenly everybody's putting it on their shelves just to be safe. They're talking their doctor into prescribing it. Well, now it's on the shelves. It's not people, I know this for a fact, that there are people who need that medicine, who have autoimmune disease, who cannot get it now. Guess where they're going to end up? In the hospital. They end up in the hospital, they overload the system, they get infected, they can infect the doctors. And now people who need, as you're saying, elective or urgent operations, other, what about everybody else? People coming in with heart attacks and strokes and all the other things that hospitals are for. So that's why we have to flatten that curve. We can't say it enough. And that's why, on the one hand, you're thinking, are we overdoing it right now? And on the other hand, we don't have the data to say really what exactly is going on. And as Tony Fauci, who's the head of infectious diseases for the National Institute of Health, has been saying, if you think you're doing too much, you're probably either doing just the right amount or not enough. So right now, I would say, in conclusion, go for it everywhere widely. The downside is, yes, there's huge economic stress. But right now, for this moment in time, whether it's 2 weeks or 4 weeks or whatever it is, I think we have to do it.
I agree with you. I agree with you. But it's vital, vital that we get more information as quickly as possible.
Yes. And then also it's reassuring. So I did a 60-minute piece about coronavirus a couple of weeks ago. And Tom Inglesby, who, believe it or not, in October at the Pierre Hotel, he's from Hopkins, Johns Hopkins, ran a simulation with all these leaders, including the head of CDC from China, to say, what would happen if we had a pandemic of, wait for it, coronavirus? Wow. In October. They predicted everything that's going on. And at the very end of it, we went back and forth. And I said, you know, it's a natural instinct for public health officials to want to reassure, right? And he said, John, we are not departments of reassurance. We're departments of public health. And we went back and forth a little more. And basically, the idea came out of, if you level with people, if you're honest with people, and you don't infantilize them, and you tell them the truth in the right way, even if the news, even if the facts are worrisome, that whole process in and of itself is reassuring. The best antidote for fear is facts.
Dr. LaPook, we love you. You're going to come. By the way, Sir Angela Weber, Dr. LaPook is here every single day, twice a day.
So feel free to join us at any time, because he's always here for us.
And I just learned I'm going to be on the CBS Evening News tonight. We're doing a chat with Nora O'Donnell, because now I've set up with a thing called Live View from my apartment, so we can do live back and forth. So 6:30 to 7 Eastern Standard Time.
And we'll see you at 8 o'clock tonight. Thank you, Dr. LaPook. You're amazing.
Thank you, Dr. LaPook.
Happy birthday, Angela Lloyd Webber.
Happy birthday.
Thank you, my dear. Thank you.
We have one of your phantoms. There's Norman Lewis here as well.
Hello. Happy birthday.
Guilty, because it was a beautiful day in the country yesterday, and there was I self-isolating. It's true. But I couldn't complain. And it was a really lovely day. Took the cats for a walk, plus my new dog, Mojito. And there we go.
Everybody,
you guys. Hello, Irene. Hello, everybody.
Happy birthday.
Okay, so I'd love to have a little Angela Weber music, and then I have to chat with you for a second. But Sierra, can you please inform Mr. Lloyd Webber about what happened to you in Las Vegas? I don't know if he knows the full extent of I think he needs to know why your smile is so beautiful.
Or why I had to get the camera just right so that you can't see my fake tooth so bad.
Yes,
no, Andrew knows that I fell through the stage right at, have you got your carpet hot in your last four blood? Which then turned into a lispy, have you gorged yourself at last in your lustful blood? Because my tooth popped clean out my mouth.
You fell down. How far was the trap you fell down?
Well, though in Vegas, we had more traps because we could do more things, and they were bigger. So I fell all the way in. The wedding dress saved my life. So I'm hanging in the stage like this. My face hits the stage. Anthony Crivello, who was my phantom with his phantom face, is staring at me like, oh, like looking at me while I'm like, and I, all I thought is, well, at least I don't have to smile in this scene.
Well, Sierra, also, you can now go through the rest of your life saying, my wedding dress saved my life.
Exactly, Andrew. Wedding dress saved my life.
So Sierra, give us a little song, and then we're going to come back with everybody celebrating Andy's birthday. So I'm going to take them off screen. Sierra, sing whatever you want.
Everybody else, stand by.
Yeah, so stand by. Don't go nowhere. Don't go nowhere.
Somebody wants to come on and sing Raul.
Who does?
I have to sing me in three languages.
Oh, okay. I hope it
is. Someone here is going to sing Raul.
Ramin, sing it.
You decide, Seth. Just bring us up when you want us.
All right. It doesn't always sync up, so maybe a nightmare with this live stream. We'll see. And then we're going to bring back ALW.
Okay. Can you hear?
Yeah.
Think of me, they call me fondly when we said goodbye. Remember me every so often. Promise me you'll try. Thank you. On that day, that not so distant, when you are afraid, if you ever find a hammer, a spare thought for mine.
Is it you still?
Yes, Ramin. I have lots more verses. Japanese. Kono yo no aiwa hakana. You make a mabodo shika. Kido ase nuchi. Kokoro futaku. Natsu najipi to otu misari. Ima ne yukite kaerasu. French. Souviens-toi quand je te tendais muette et résignée. Imagine-toi tous les efforts fournis pour t'oublier. Souviens-toi, je t'en prie, souviens-toi, où que tu sois, quoi qu'il revienne. Il n'y aura jamais un jour sans que je ne me souvienne.
Someone sing Raul.
Can it be Kristin? Bravo! Bravo! Long ago, it seems so long ago. A young and innocent we were. You may not remember me, but I remember.
Flowers fade, the fruits of summer fade. They have their seasons, so do we. But please promise me that sometimes
Welsh one, that was terrific. I didn't know you spoke Welsh, Sierra.
I know, Andrew. I just full of surprises. You know, you think you know a person.
Your voice has come on so much. I really thought the beginning was fabulous.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Need to take. I've been trying to get my Kristins to do that for years, yeah. And now you don't do it. I love that. That's great.
Well, great. Well, I'm happy to train people in the pop style of singing.
Exactly, because
that one would hire me for.
Indeed, that's the way. It's the future, really. I feel, don't you?
I do.
I think. What do you think? Do the whole thing in 4/4 time with a proper sort of, proper Britney musical. It could be. Could it?
Yep. And I'm available, as are all of us.
Oh, now I know. It's a separate theatre. I think nobody will be able to get near a bite. I mean. Or at least for a day.
No, we've already sold out just talking about this. It's over, you know.
Well, sold out in what sense of the word?
So much comedy. Okay, wait, Angela Weber, can I just ask you about some of your sort of atonal phrases? You can pick which one, like how you came up with either this or come up with those weird ass phrases? Go.
Well, now you see. Do you want me to get technical?
Yes.
Isn't it? Da da. You know that it's the triton, which is the middle note of the scale.
Yes.
Because the whole conceit of Phantom is that the Phantom was writing out of his time. So 19th century music didn't tend to use anything like the whole tone scale. So that's why we do da 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 da. You see. Exactly. And because it's all in whole tones. It's a private joke. There's one story about Phantom I must tell. And because one of the things that I always love doing is something in 7/8 time. And I did that to Lynn's George song yesterday. And it's something I've always wanted to do. And we have one joke in Phantom of the Opera about 7/8 time, which is after seven. And it's only been laughed at once in the entire month that I know of. And I was in the audience when somebody did laugh, and I thought, yeah, laugh. And it was the conductor, Lauren Marzell, who came and said, he said that he thought he's the only person who ever got it. But I love all those sort of intervals, you know, da 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 da, you know, it's da da. And I tell you who did use that interval a lot, but in a different way, was Richard Rodgers. Because he did da 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 da, or Bally High, da da da.
And also, Bernstein.
Yeah. It's a great thing about anything to do with music and everything is that, you know, in the end, there are only two types of music, as Duke Ellington said, good and bad. And there are no areas in music that you can't go to. Mm. And I think what Bernstein did in West Side Story, I mean, when you listen to it today, I mean, it is as contemporary as anything possibly could be. Fantastic.
So, but by the way, speaking of your 7/8, you're right, because I'm thinking of all the shows I've done of yours with the Who's the Thief, Who's the Thief, Who's the Thief, and also Money Kept Rolling In and Sunset Boulevard. You love 7/8.
Well, yeah, so Sunset, actually, the title song, that's in 5/8.
Oh, it is? Oh, busted. You love Odd Number 8.
No, I've never written a title song yet in 7/8. Must try. I'll try to in my next one.
Cinderella.
Yeah. Your Cinderella could go in 7/8. I think I'll try and find, I'll make sure there is some.
I so appreciate it.
Guys will clock it immediately. It's Emmanuel Miranda who said to me, the first person I came across who read, said to me, you know, every single one of your shows has got something in 7.
What's up? Well, I just think the music is so advanced. And I'm just so fascinated. Just give me 2 seconds. Like, do you sit at the piano and you just go plunk, plunk, plunk? Or do you scientifically think something and then you play it?
Well, you know, I mean, the one thing about musical theater, funny enough, I just come off a long conference call, you know, because we're doing anything by, you know, whatever it's called, Skype or whatever, I don't know what it's called. You know, talking to everybody again. And the music comes, you know, from the story. Everything, I mean, in my case, I'm entirely story-driven. So I try and write what is dramatically right for the particular moment in the story. So I don't sort of sit down and say, I've got to write this first. I mean, what I'll do now is after the call, which I've just had, I'll go and have a think. And I'll think, you know, what is the right thing for the particular moment we've been talking about, which is a slightly different way. Sometimes, you know, it can come when you're walking around the place. There is no hard blast rule. Sometimes it's at the piano, but I tend to find that it's just when you're thinking it. Musical theatre or writing for musicals is a bit like doing a jigsaw puzzle. You know, it is a puzzle in the end, and it's getting everything to be in the right place. You need, you could write a scene in isolation, and then it could destroy the scene that's coming up. I mean, it isn't a precise science. It's all about really the story first, in my case, always, and then what is the musical balance. But I do love planting little ideas and little motifs, which is really why I like writing, if I can, with something that's more through written than not. I mean, there's a place for dialogue, of course, but you know, sometimes you can use dialogue as if it's a musical color.
Well, I love that all throughout Evita is, you know, A, B, tip it on, or just listen to that. I mean, constantly there's that phrase. But let me say something. You really brought the extreme high belting to Broadway, which I'm completely obsessed with. When you wrote, you know, it's important to you. when you wrote that for a high E, no woman had ever belted that note before. What made you think anyone could possibly belt that note?
Well, funnily enough, I guess when we did the demo of it, originally, it was with a girl called Julie Covington.
Julie Covington, I know, the White Album. I love it.
She did it on the album, and then that was, she could do it. She wanted to do it, and it kind of stuck. I mean, it doesn't actually have to be as high as that, but it's pretty thrilling when it is.
Oh, it's so crazily exciting. Okay, I have a million questions to ask you. You have to come back. Sierra Boggess, can you give us the, you have more tracks, can you give us the song that you sang with Sir Lord when you were in his castle and the
Lord.
Queen?
Lord Andrew.
Lord. When the queen was there and then she left and you guys were just hanging out.
That's a great story.
Oh, yeah.
When the queen left and then we all gathered around the piano.
Yeah.
And then we all had a sing song. And first we started singing. Actually, didn't we first start singing Do a Deer, a Female?
Yes.
And then we got crazy. And then we sang Wishing.
Yeah, we did Wishing. No, she loved that. She loved that. She's always wanted to do another one. I'm letting you into a secret. But of course, you know, we're all a bit locked down at the moment. And
we're all locked down. But we were like completely sworn to secrecy when we had to do this for, or when we got to do this for the Queen, and we couldn't say anything. And this was
not
even
before, no.
What?
No, well, not beforehand. Because, you know, obviously, you know, it's one has to keep that quiet.
Yeah.
But she loves, as you know, I mean, but you also sang for her a couple of really interesting songs. It was quite, she has a great sort of love of people like Cole Porter. And going right back to when, you know, she was, of course, young. I mean, the songs of the 40s. And Miss Otis Regrets is a song she loves.
Really?
Yes, it's quite interesting. I mean, but it's what you'd expect in a way. And she used to, but of course, she loved all the Rodgers and Hammerstein shows, all the early ones.
That's the ones that I think Julian and I sang.
People Say We're in Love.
We Were in Love and yeah. If I Loved You.
If I Loved You, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Andrew, do you just like text the Queen and you're like, do you want to come over for a show?
Not exactly. But, you know, she does.
I did.
Yeah, you did it actually. Yeah.
And here, I would love the Queen to come over. I've got my phone out and text the Queen.
Lord Andrew, I thought you'd appreciate this comment. Phantom is a prime example of how to properly self-quarantine.
Well, with his mask. I know it's totally effective.
Well, speaking of masks, I want to just say, hold on, I'm hiding this. Ramin, I found a photo of you with the Phantom mask. Well, that's great, but you know, there's another photo of you holding the mask online.
Oh, no, not in front of Andrew now. Come on. You've done this enough times. No more.
I haven't done anything.
Not in this venue.
Just
want to
show us a certain. Oh, no, that's not it. Excuse me.
There's not even a mask there.
No, that's not it. Oh, there we go.
Sir, I'm so sorry.
Oh, my God. Wait, where's the one of me doing that?
Cut. Well, I mean, can you please tell Andrew Lloyd Webber where you were when he wanted you to audition for Love Never Dies? Well, I mean, you've got to be honest on my show. That's the point of this show, is honesty.
You brought Andrew on so you can have therapy session. Remember?
Right.
I remember, well, Andrew, oh, he was not going to remember, but I remember I came to sing for you at the offices back in Covent Garden.
Oh, yeah, in the old ones.
And I couldn't read music, so Simon was pigeoning it to me in my ear, and I sang. And before I was supposed to, your office was calling for me to come to the office. Unbeknownst to me, I didn't know why, but I was at a beautician's getting a treatment done. And then when I finished singing Till I Hear You Sing with you, as we found a key and whatnot, you went, well, that's how you should sing it. You should get your back waxed more often. I'm like, why'd my agent tell you that?
We need to know things like that. I want everyone watching right now to please donate to the Actors Fund.
Yes,
Sierra is going to serenade. Oh, we got some donations.
We got some more donations here.
Now, by the way, the Actors Fund is for everybody across the United States, not just actors, dancers, musicians, makeup artists, box office personnel, ushers. Nobody is working. People live check to check. Wedding singers, bar mitzvah singers, my people. I mean, really, everybody, and Actors Fund needs money more than ever. So read some of the donations, please.
Yes, sir. Lord Andrew, is there an actor's fund or equivalent in the UK that people can go to help support the artists there?
Yes, there is. And luckily, actually, the government has announced various measures that I think may help, which is very good. Yes, so there is an actors fund, but there are all sorts of them. I mean, as there are in America, you know, for older actors too, and retired people. But it is something. I mean, it's without anything. It's beyond any of our experiences at all. And of course, for the thing that, you know, I often think to myself, I mean, this is, you know, the theatre has been my life, you know, and it is my life. And I think for all of us, this is something which is just almost impossible to come to terms with. Yeah. I mean, it affects all of us. And it is, as I heard earlier, it is really very important, though, that we all pull together now to help each other. But we mustn't, you know, just think because we're theatre people that we are, you know, in some kind of ivory tower. We are all part of a community, and it's really, really important that we all help each other and pull together in as many ways as we possibly can. And you know, and certainly from my end, and I think everybody I know in theatre feels exactly the same way. And we're all trying to work out what's the best way of using our own, you know, our own talents and our own abilities, you know, to help as many people as possible.
Yeah, we've started auctioning off props. We had Joanna Gleason on, who has the original staff from Into the Woods that Bernadette Peters held, and she's auctioning that off now. She's had it for 30 years. So people are just finding props in their houses and they're auctioning them off.
And the other thing that Seth had was a great idea that could apply to people that are in London, or people that, if you bought tickets for an upcoming show, instead of asking for your money back, donate it to the arts organization.
Yeah, just let them keep it and don't ask for a refund, because this is going to destroy the smaller theaters.
So these are some donations that just came in. Kevin from North Carolina donated $50. From Connecticut, James and Kathleen, $75. Matthew from California, $50. Leah from Georgia, $15. Lisa from New York, $50. Philip from Ohio, $250. PC from New York, $100. Riley from Florida, $50. Rosemary from Pennsylvania, $25. Pam from New York, $50. Sophia from Washington, $15. Laura from Texas, $25. Edward from California, $100.
And these little donations.
Thank you so much, you guys. Thank you. Thank you.
Every day we're getting these little basket donations. They've added up so far to $80,000. We just began last Monday.
And we know we'll be up to $100,000 really soon.
Awesome.
So, Sierra, will you please serenade us? We're getting so many comments. You have the actual composer there. Now, by the way, one last thing. Everyone needs to read Unmasked, Angela Weber's book. It's so fascinating. And what I didn't know is basically Angela Weber wrote the plot to Phantom. I mean, it's so fascinating, all that stuff. Because I played in that orchestra for probably 15 years on Broadway. I have no idea you came up with all those plot points. It's fascinating to me. So you've got to read his book. It's called Unmasked, and it's got so many inside scoops.
It's not a very good title for this time, is it?
Or is it?
Get rid of the un. All right, so Sierra, so speaking of masks, all right, but no, that's so inappropriate. I should not be showing that. All right, Sierra, what?
I want a copy of it. Can you send it round to me? Ramin, please. Then I'll get them, then we can auction them off.
Done. I'm down with that, sir.
And you before you go,
I'll find one's worth more than the unsigned ones. I'm just checking.
Well, we've got a few to choose from, sir.
I'm staying out of it.
A good British equivalent is Acting for Others. That they take care of like a whole bunch of organizations here as well. So that's
I'm gonna put that up. Acting for Others. So yeah, if you can, you know, if you're listening right now in London, where is that? If you're listening in London, it'd be great if you're gonna help anybody in the UK that's out of work.
All of United Kingdom, not just London.
All right, I forgot. The UK, as we call it. Thank you.
Yeah. I think
everyone calls it, to be honest, but yeah, whatever.
I mean, you're on my show. Okay, Sierra, please give us something. I'm stepping out.
Okay, I'm singing Wishing. My one companion, you were all that mattered. You were once a friend and father,
than my wall would shatter. Wishing you were small here again. Wishing you were somehow near. Sometimes it seemed if I just dreamed, somehow you would be here. Wishing I could hear your voice again, one that I never would. Dreaming of you won't help me to do all that you dreamed I could. Passing bells and sculpted angels called and one mentor. Seeing by you the wrong companion, you were warm and gentle. Too many years fighting back tears. Why can't that boss just die? Wishing you were somehow here again. Knowing I can't say goodbye. Try to forgive. Teach me to live. Give me the strength to try. Help me say goodbye. Help me say goodbye.
Sierra, amazing. And look at this, all around the world, the closest I'll get to seeing both of you singing live Love from Indonesia.
Oh, wow.
If we want to say goodbye, we want to say goodbye. Here's Dr. John LaPook to say goodbye.
And I think Norm.
Bye. Hey. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Happy birthday.
Bye.
Happy birthday,
Andrew.
Thank you. Happy birthday.
Tune in tonight. Thank you, everyone. 8 p.m. tonight, Eastern. Bryce Mitchell and Audrey McDonald, 8 p.m. tonight, Eastern. And special surprise guest. I'm going to give away.
Okay.
But it's going to be Angela Weber and Audrey McDonald. And Dr. LaPook, of course. Thank you, Sierra. Thank you, everyone.
6:30 tonight on the CBS Evening News, I'm going to be chatting with Nora O'Donnell about a lot of stuff having to do with coronavirus and COVID-19.
Is that 6:30 Eastern or 6:30 wherever you are?
Eastern time, 6:30. I think it rolls across the country. I don't know if you have it in London.
And Sierra, you have to get Lord Andrew back. Everyone has to come back. There wasn't enough time.
I mean, you're fine.
Well,
Sierra. All right, we love seeing everybody. Thank you, guys.
Oh my God. Bye, everyone. This broadcasting's the end.
Bye, you guys. Bye.
Bye, Rex. Bye.